representing Canada, Elliot Holtham.
Yeah, coming down here, I mean, you always hope to win. I actually thought I had a reasonable chance at it. I was sort of flying under the radar. I think that's my strategy. No one really takes, I come into all these races and no one even pays attention to me. I haven't been doing this that long, but I'm on a pretty steady improvement curve. It didn't really go down as I would have thought to win. To be honest, I had a huge gap coming out of the swim. The bike, which is usually when I can push, I was just losing massive amounts of time. Like, the deficit coming off the bike, I don't even remember what it was, but it was like, it was huge. Like, I didn't think I had any shot of the win coming off the bike. I was like, oh, maybe I'll get on the podium and get some Kona points, but then the gaps came down on the first lap, and I'm like, okay, I can get second here. And then they told me Luke was walking, so I'm like, okay. But everyone's like, it's yours to lose. And I'm like, you know what? There's a long way to go. It's like 20K left. It's not over until I cross, you know, turn around that corner and no one's there.
Yeah. What's it like when people are saying stuff like, it's yours to lose? Does that spur you on or does it freak you out a little bit?
It freaks me out a little bit. You know, it's a bit of pressure. I mean, you only get, you know, a few shots putting a good day together like this, right?
Now, we've been chatting to your coach all day.
Oh, have you?
Yeah, he's been giving me your bio and everything.
Oh, yeah.
I know that you work full time.
Yeah.
PhD.
I do. Geophysics.
That's it?
Yeah.
What are you doing full time? Like, I assume it's in the same sort of industry as what your PhD is in.
Yeah, so we do computer modeling, mostly for mineral and oil and gas exploration. So I work usually a 40-hour week.
Yeah, wow.
That's why I'm actually supposed to fly out tomorrow morning. And I got here on Friday. So I left Wednesday at 11 p.m., got here Friday at noon, and then raced Sunday morning. But I wasn't really sure what was going to happen, to be honest, because I've come to Australia twice for work, actually. And every time I've come here, the flight, it's about a 16-hour flight to Sydney, and it has just destroyed me, like completely destroyed me. And one of my friends is a doctor back home. He's giving me some, you know, just telling me to rest and, you know, giving me some good tips for the flight. And I actually felt a lot more rested here. So I was like, oh, maybe I can do this. So.
So now with in under your belt,
yeah,
and looking at all the work you're doing, is this a good indication that you might want to switch to professional triathlete full time?
We'll see. I don't think my boss would like that too much. We won't tell her that. But we'll see. I'm still improving a lot. I mean, I haven't really been doing this that long. I started with my coach Bjorn Ossenbrink in the spring of 2011. So, you know, I think I've come a long way in 3 years. I mean, starting in 2011, I was, you know, back of the pack pro. And then 2012, I was sort of moving forward. Last year, I had some I podiumed at 70.3 in an Ironman, so sort of moving up, but we're in the right direction. Today just really, I'm still surprised, like it didn't start off as I would have hoped. Like the bike, you know, there was just huge deficits, and I never expected to be losing that much time out there. And like I was saying, my Garmin broke on the first downhill. I only hit a bump. So I launched all my nutrition for the first, so like 5 minutes in, I had no watch to take my nutrition, no nutrition and no power. So
oh, wow.
So I was like just flying by the seat of my pants, and I was like, oh, I can't see how hard I'm working, so I don't know why I'm losing all this time. But so I went pretty easy, and then started pushing the pace a little bit on the end, but the gaps were huge. So I just stuck with it, and the gap started coming down a lot on the run.
Yeah.
I don't think it was particularly quick because I was cramping pretty bad after about 15K.
Oh, right.
So I was like starting to get all these twinges. I was taking 2 salt pills every aid station. I was like, I'd rather my stomach cramp than my legs.
Yeah.
I'm like, I had to slow the pace down just so I didn't cramp. I actually felt pretty good energy-wise. I just didn't want to overdo it because if your legs cramp, you're in a lot of trouble.
Yeah.
I raced Luke last year in Lake Stevens.
Yeah.
And that was sort of a big breakthrough for me.
Yeah.
him and Craig and I were rode together, and then we ran the first 10K together, and they dropped me. So I've been working out on my run a little bit more after that. It was a good motivation, but I knew he had a bit of an injury. I didn't know he still had it. I knew that he had suffered something in Western Australia or something. I purposely didn't look at the start list.
Oh, wow.
Because I made the call to book the flight, and I'm like, you know what? I'm coming down here. I don't want to know it. So I didn't know who was racing. I knew Luke was racing. I didn't know Paul was racing until yesterday when I racked my bike.
Thank you.
The people were so encouraging out there on the run.
Oh, good.
I love the four-loop run. Yeah. I feel like everyone was behind me, especially... this is actually, I think, the first race I've gone to was out, you know, some teammates and my family there. So, you know, Nashie and his family have been a huge support. They picked me up at the airport, so I felt like I had a family here. But it was nice that everyone out here was super supportive, you know, cheering for me. And, you know, Canada, one guy was singing the Canadian National Anthem when I was out there. So I was just trying to hold it together.